But to look your enemy in the eye, knowing you'll remember his face for the rest of your life, now that takes a stomach much stronger than you'll ever have.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome back to Girl Gaming. Now, you haven't seen very many videos from me recently, and I do apologize for that. Life has been incredibly busy, and I'm terribly sorry. But we are going to explode back onto the scene with a new Modders on Modding. Larvo of the Sins community has very, very kindly offered to create a video that shows us how to put an existing ship mesh into Sins of a Solar Empire. It's a really fascinating video, and I really, really enjoyed watching it, and I can't wait to share it all with you. So without further ado, here we go!
Hello and welcome. My name is Lavo, guy behind Sins of the Galactic Empire, part of the Sins of the Prophets team, part of the Axanar team, and also done some other silly random things for other people. Today we are going to go over exporting and preparing models for Sins of the Solar Empire. This will cover from the actual importing images into soft image, all the way to the actual convert XSI process. Now, if you have a model already done, like you made the model, you UV'd it, you've made textures, and it's just sitting in 3ds Max, that's great, because you'll be able to skip the step I'm just about to do. Now, if you actually don't have that, or what you want to do is actually reverse import something from Sins itself in order to, you know, fix up the tangent mapping, do some work on it, like add some turrets, do some fixes to the model itself, etc. You are actually able to do that nowadays, thanks to some nice programs. There previously, which I'll be including in the download section, there is a free script for 3ds Max that does this, called the Sins Max tool, or Sins Rep tool, depending on the version you have. That you go to download that, you go, okay, utilities, run script, navigate to wherever you exported it, then you open it up here, and then you click import text and bin, find your thing, like let's look at this Covenant assault carrier, which is the Prophets, and hey, look, here it is, and you can start working on it that way. There is a limitation, however, with this tool, is that it does not really cannot really properly import multi-material meshes. Multi-material means that the tech, that the model has multiple different skins. However, you are not screwed, even if that's the case for you, because there is another way to import such meshes. I'll be going over that right now. One way to do that is using a program called 3D Object Converter. This is admittedly a paid software, but as a version like 4.6, at least, this software is actually able to handle meshes. Now, I'm going to actually do that, and where I'm going to import a Carrick, which is a frigate from Sins of the Galactic Empire. Import it. Oh wait, whoops, no, that was the wrong thing to do. No, what you need to do, no, you don't need to open it. First you go to Batch Convert, and you add the file. Okay, you know, or you can even convert, mass convert all the stuff in a directory by going here, adding, navigating to the, adding the directory, but we don't really want to do that. And importantly, under Export Format, you're going to want to go all the way down to Wavefront, which will convert it to the well-known OBJ format. It's going to go the same direct. No, it's going to import it somewhere else. Boy, I can't figure out where I made to put this folder. Soci Lobby, here we go. It's actually made a little folder for today's video. Just to keep everything in one place. Set the folder. Click. And then we go convert file. Wait a couple of seconds. And hey, look, it's done. Now with that done, we go back into 3ds Max. And go import. You go navigate to where we exported it to, and oh hey look, here it is. Now you can import all these things, but you probably don't need to bother with smoothing groups, because we are going to be making new ones. And import. It's going to tell me, look, you don't have the textures, and I'm really annoyed. But see, as you can see here, it imported both of the material groups. That issue. And now we have our model. Very nice little thing, but as you can probably tell from the lighting, it doesn't have proper, especially for these four panels near the front here, that the lighting is off, because the smoothing on this ship was not properly done. So, question is logging, well, how do you get proper smoothing done? Proper hard edges? Well, you navigate over now to the Modify panel, hit Polygon. Ta-da. And seeing as how this thing already has some really bad smoothing group, we're just going to clear all of these. And boom! Yay, we're part of the way there. Now, for smoothing groups, there's a couple of ways to do it. One is you just select all, you play or do various configurations with this number. Personally, I found that using 35 or 25 tends to work reasonably well. Put in 35 and click auto smooth and you're done. Or if you're actually, you know what you're doing with this program, which I admittedly don't, you can actually manually, you can actually manually make your own smoother group. Like for example, let's say there's another vault at the end of this ship, but I'm not going to work on that. But you can just take like all... Can't really get rid of... Okay, no, let's take something else as an example. Say for example the back of this dish here. You can literally select all the parts of it. Okay, I'm just going to keep selecting other parts of the ship no matter what I do. So, whatever. So I do not know how to deselect. I apologize. There is a way, I'm sure, but I do not know it. But essentially you can select all of these parts of the disc or whatever portion it is in question. And then once you've once you've done all that, you can just click, click smoothing group, and then, hey, look, we just made our own smoothing group. And you can do this for every single portion of the ship and make your own custom smoothing group. But that, as you can see, takes a lot of work, and more importantly, means you have to know what you're actually doing with the model and what you want to do with it. And I do not have that skill. So that being said, we will go with the easy auto-smooth option. Now, once you've made all of your smoothing groups, you're not out of the woods yet, as you need to make sure to detach these to element. So you select the smoothing group, go select by SG, do this for each and every part of the groups. Then go down to the Edit Geometry section and click Detach and make sure that Detached Element is checked off. And then you repeat this for every single smoothing group on the model. Done. Now with that done, you've added hard edging to the model. As you can see, it's already a bit better than how it was before. But you will see that the edging group done by, auto edging group done by 3DS is not always perfect. But you can fix that in SoftImage, which we will go over as soon as we have this exported. Now, to export, you go down to Export option. Go down to our sample folder. And for this type, we select Autodesk Crosswalk. Crosswalk is actually a separate installation from 3ds Max proper. I have included a link to Autodesk Crosswalk in the description of this video, so you can grab it from there. Yes, export, name it whatever you want, not to be confusing, because even though we're exporting with XSI Crosswalk in here, the final product from SoftImage will also be a .xsi, but the one that we're doing right now can't be handled by the Sims converter, so make sure you don't confuse the two. Now, once you hit Crosswalk, you have an option for export options. Make sure that Triangulate is checked off, and you can leave Animation and Verbose checked off. Click OK. Sometimes, if you've attached textures in Crosswalk, you'll actually get an error message of some sort, so about materials and whatnot. Just when that pops up, just click OK, because it doesn't actually mean anything in truth. Now, with 3ds Max done, we go over to SoftImage. SoftImage is a old legacy program that is available for free for non-commercial use. Again, a download link will be provided in the description of this video. And this software is actually mandatory for use, even though you can do hardpoint rigging in 3DS, you cannot properly apply tangent mappings in 3DS. People have tried making export tools and all sorts of things to get it to work in 3DS, but for one reason or another, unfortunately, none of these have ever worked. Now, those of you who are familiar with SoftImage 7.5, that works for your computer too. Well, that works too. Unfortunately, in my own specific case, 7.5 doesn't like working on my computer. Now, the layout for my version SoftImage 6 for some reason looks like this, and this is very terrible. So we're going to go to something more familiar. We're going to go down to View, Layouts, Defaults. And now this will be much more familiar to those people who use 7.5 and even people with proper version 6. And on the top here we have a nice tab for General, Primitives, Selections. Selections is going to be really important for us. And so what that is the main shelf. We're going to make sure that's enabled. So we're going to go to optional panels, make sure we have main shelf on. And then we're going to go to the selection tab. Now, what are we going to do to bring our model that we just made in 3DS into SoftImage? Well, we're going to go to File, Crosswalk Imports. See, this is why we do the crosswalk. So we can use this nice little thing. Navigate to our sample folder. And we have 3DS crosswalks. And boom, we have a model. Now, one thing I'll note for this applies to both versions of Softimage 6 and 7.5. If you hit the S key on your keyboard, your cursor will change into this nice little tool, and you can actually navigate to the left, up, down, left, right. And if you right-click hold, you can rotate the model in the user view, which is very nice, very useful. And if you're in 7.5, you can use your mouse wheel to zoom in and out. If you're in 6, you have to click and hold the middle mouse button. Now we have our model. It looks very white for some reason. And it's also not oriented correctly, because as you can see, it is pointing backwards. Now if we can fix this, you click 8 on your keyboard to bring up the Explorer menu. You go down to the model, and we play around with it in the rotation tab. Oops. That's not. And we play around until we find the rotation angle that we want. And here it is. Now it is properly oriented. As we can see from the front and from the right side. And also then reset the user setting. Now what we're going to do is we're going to take this model and drag it all the way up to the scene root. You can get rid of the max scene roots and crosswalk import options. Don't need those anymore. And now that we've properly oriented the model, we're going to go to transform, freeze all transformations. This will reset the rotation counter to 000, which is important as otherwise the rotation will be ignored in the conversion, so it will be clearly unoriented. This, I must note, applies only towards the model. Hard points can be left with their angle, like for example minus 90 or whatever other angle settings you want to use. Purely the model has to be set to 111 and 000. Okay, now that we have the model here, we see that plenty of things have hard edges. Plenty of things. And I'm actually looking for an area that can, here. As we recall from earlier, this was meant to be a primarily circular bulge, yet for one reason or another 3DS thought it would be a good idea to add some hard edges to it, and so this is something we probably want to get rid of. I'm going to use the right tab here, just out of preference, go to hidden line removal and maximize. So question is, how do we get rid of these hard edges that we don't want? Well, what we do is we go down to Polymesh, and then Modify section, and Weld Point Tool. And we just keep clicking the points that make up that line until they go away. Sometimes you have to keep clicking and take a chance. Make sure you hold the undo button down. Click. And that's like the first section here. There's other parts, but I will probably bore you if I completely fix up this model on screen. But I'll just fix the other side here for testing sake. Or actually no, And But as you can see, as you do more points, the soft image's response time gets slower and slower. This applies also when you're adding edges, but this is because when you expand polymesh, you see this thing called weld point off. So it has to keep track of all of these when you weld a point again. Now, to get rid of these, free up everything, you go down to edit on the bottom here and click freeze. This will sort of condense everything and, in other words, just make it work in the way that you want it. Now, another thing you're probably wondering is, how do you add hard edges? Like, say you think that something is missing, like see over here. There's an edge that should be right where my cursor is. Now, how do you fix that problem? There's a few, or even over here. Well, there's a few ways that you can do this, and I'll show both ways. One is we go back to our wonderful selection tab and hit what is called the raycast edge. For this, we actually just select the edge that we want, or edges. You can click shift to add more edges, and you can hold down control to get rid of them. Then we go down to disconnect components. And now when we unselect, we see, oh hey look, now there is a hard edge on this side to match the other side. And there is another way as well. Say rather than just wanting to do an edge, you have like a whole plate here, like this whole square. You want to have edges all around it. Then you go down to raycast polygon. Click and hold. And again, shift to add, control to get rid of. And then you go down to disconnect components. And now as you can see, there have been edges added all around the triangle. This can be faster than just using raycast edge, but of course it's less precise, and sometimes you want that precision. And again, now like when we had the weld tool off, we now have disconnect component off, and we again go select them, have the model selected, and go down to freeze to condense everything. Now, some people might be wondering, if you haven't properly made a material in 3DS, can you do it in Softimage? The answer to this is yes. As you can see here in the back of the mesh, just going to navigate to another tab for me, make it easier to see. The engine section here has an odd, looks like it's a light discolored gray. Now the reason for this is a separate component, separate material. We expand the cluster section, we see something called polygon. This polygon is another material, another texture group. This is where the engines are, over here. And say we didn't have this texture group. I'm just going to save this in case I do anything wrong. Yeah, it doesn't like that it can't find my textures. Say we didn't have this texture group here, this engine. How, Vapo, would we make this in Softimage? Well, we go back to the good old raycast polygon. You have to make sure the model is selected first. And then we select all of the parts. And then we go to I actually am forgetting here, create cluster. That's what we do. We go to create cluster. And see, as you can see here, we once again created a texture group in the same way, in the same place. It's also just called polygon because that's just the default naming. If you really want, you can actually change it, the naming, like name it engines. Doesn't really make a difference. I'm just going to reopen Carrick model because it probably is correct, but I prefer using the original materials just for safety's sake. And now I'm just going to quickly go over how do you make texture groups for all of these things. So we go down to View, Rendering Texturing, Materials Manager. Now if you did the export process from 3DS properly, you're going to probably have this thing called a Max Material Library. Delete that. It's not a proper material library and it just doesn't really work well. Now we have, again, multiple materials here. We have the engine material, we have the baseline material, so to speak, and probably wondering, well, what, how do we add in textures? How do we assign these groups to different texture groups? To do this, we have the texture group that we want, for example, the main mesh, or in this case, the engine group. With the engine group selected, we right-click on the new material and click Assign to Selection. And now this will exclusively work for the engines. And of course, we can also rename all of these for easy use, so we know what is what. Another thing worth noting is that if you want to display a different specific texture, you can actually do that under the OpenGL display and the options menu, but I'll go over that in a moment once we actually have the textures rigged up. Now to do that, you're going to need to do texture, go to nodes, texture image. Then you can either go to new from file, navigate to what texture you want, or alternatively what you can do if you have like all of your textures in one folder, navigate to that folder. In this case we want mcarrickhull. Just drag and drop into the box. Then we navigate there, click text. That'll attach it to the image here. And then we navigate here, and then we just attach it appropriately. Diffuse is the CL texture. Ambient is the NM or normal map texture, and specular is the DA or data texture. In this case, this is diffuse, so click diffuse. I don't know why this is calling itself DDS1, but make sure that the proper extension here is recorded at the end. Otherwise, when the model is exported, it won't really attach the textures right. Of course, you can attach textures outside of Softimage, and I'll go over that once we export. But back to the OpenGL display here, because if you have the normal map attached, if you go down to say texture decal, it will actually display the normal map, diffuse map instead of the color map, which would be one. So what you can go is click mode, use specific image UV pair, then go to image clip and click the color you want, the texture you want, and then boom, it will now properly show the texture setting that you want in Softimage. Ta-da! This can be useful when, you know, rigging up mesh points, which is the next item on our list. The next item once we finish the current thing. Because now that we have properly done the hard edges for this model. And we've also attached textures, which is just an additional bonus. We are now ready to do tangent mapping because we're not doing any further alterations to the model itself. Now to do this, we first have the model selected. We go down to Property, Texture Projection, Cubic. This will create an additional little texture for us to use. Now usually Cubic will make a cubic projection that is big enough to cover the whole model, but in the cases that it doesn't for whatever reason, you can select it. In this case, just we use this box select tool, and we're just going to increase the size of the projection slightly. Wait, what? Oh, whoops! I accidentally had the box selected too. Let's get it back. Let's see. As you can see now, the model is now sufficiently covered. Before, this part wasn't really covered so much. And now that we've made the cube projection, we again select the model and go down to Property, Tangent. Now we expand clusters, expand node properties, and click the cubic projection that we made earlier. And afterwards, we go down to Tangents, Tangent Op 2, and we drag this all the way to the maximum for smoothing. Now, to properly look at our shading, we go down to Shading, and we can now look at the model. As you can see, places with very clearly defined edge groups have their own solid color, whereas things that are more circular, such as our bulb from here, have a bit of a more of a multicolored display. This is, of course, all good and intentional. Well, in other words, if you see, like over here, up here, there's some seemingly divergence of color. And oh yeah, you see, because of that, there's an edge right here on this line that could use being added. Of course, to do this, we again would go down to the raycast edge, create the edge, freeze the model. But then once we add more points, more lines, we're going to have to recreate the cubic UV map, so you delete that, and you again select the model, go down to cubic, and then we double click the tangent again, go back to our pick session, click the new cubic UV, go back, open the tangent off again, and guide this all the way to the end. And now, as of right now, the model itself is actually finished and ready for export. But, of course, there are no hard points rigged to the mesh, which, as we all know in Sims, is a problem because everybody loves seeing very fancy light bolts and missiles and boom, boom, pew, pew, pew. So, you can do this without any toolbars or plugins, but one way to speed this up very quickly is using a nice little mesh points toolbar made by MyFistZero from the Sims community. Pass off to him for this. There are ways of properly import toolbars into Softimage, but I've forgotten how to. So you can always just drag and drop into Softimage. Now, one of the really good things about this toolbar here is it basically speeds things up for you rather than having to manually create all the mesh points one by one or even just the initial root point. You can just click the various buttons you've created, for example, with buffs, and all of a sudden we have our main buff points created and we can move them around as we please. up, back down, or up in the translate tab over here, etc. Of course, you can make all of these manually if you don't have the toolbar or don't want to download it or whatever. Just go to scene routes, create group, root point. You're done. Wait, no, it's not create group. No, not create group. I'm sorry. No, it's you have to create a null, which is primitive null. Yeah, and then you rename that to root points. This case calls root point one. Then you add your points, etc., and you're done. But that being said, you can change the orientation and placement, of course, of any points. Let's just use abilities here, for example, because oftentimes people just use abilities as a single forward-facing point, where sometimes you might not necessarily want that. Now, the ability point just has an odd default setting here, so you can just double-click on the point and change things from like rings to arrow and move it up and see, hey, look, you know, it's a different position. And you can move these things forwards and backwards and wherever. From side to side. Let's just put something right in front of here. This little thingamajig. I don't recall exactly what it is, because I know it's not a cockpit. We need to raise it a bit higher, so put in a decimal point. And say now we're happy with this positioning, because it's a very big particle effect, so it looks like, you know, it will be firing from this lock, but for say for example instead, we had 2 points, so, or no, that's better, let's look at a weapon that's going to be side-firing. And first we, of course, just move it into place. Let's say it's all the way back here in the bulge that we worked on earlier to make sure that thing was curved. You go here, you move the thing in place. I'm just going to leave it at this point because it's good enough for the purposes of this example. And now, rather than making it fire forwards, we want to make it move fire towards the left side. So to do that, we just go to the Rotate tab and change the angle. And boom. Now, if we wanted, you can actually have multiple weapons in a single point. So for example, we could say this is a rounded point, so we want it to be able to fire both forwards and backwards. We can either go to click the weapon 0 button again and move the weapon in place. Alternatively, we can just go right-click on it and go to Duplicate. And this will create a copy of the weapon in the same point now. Now, as we want to keep this all within the same weapon group, we need to update the point reference, saying it's the second point of weapon 0. And then we just change the angle. Boom. Now we have a weapon firing from this round, that will fire from this round orb here, and it will fire both towards left and forwards. Say that we also wanted something that was on the other globe here. Well, easiest way is again, duplicate. And again, update the point as usual. And we move it to the other side by editing the x-coordinate. And of course by editing the angle. And boom. Now we have another weapon that's just firing from the right-hand bulge towards the right. And you can do this with any weapon that you have on the ship, making it fire towards a certain direction or angle. You can even have very interesting angles, for example ones that work with the Z-coordinate, like so. So if you want like a missile arcing that fires upwards before turning around and streaking towards the opponent. And that was the wrong button. Zero. That's the right one. And there's also another interesting opportunity. A lot of people haven't really realized this. But if you put a weapon angle to 45 degrees, then under when Sins looks at this weapon point, they'll treat it as both a forward firing weapon and a side firing weapon, because it's right on the border between both, so Sins will use it for both, which again could be useful for things like missile weapons if you have forward and side bank but want to make it look like it's only firing on one person, etc. And now say that that's done. Just going to put an exhaust point down for so the game doesn't cause a hissy fit. Now that these are done, let's export the model. So of course to do that, we make sure we have the scene route selected, double check the model, see everything is how we want it, all the edges are done, wet mesh points are done, and then we go down to File, Export, .xsi. Under Version we make sure 3.6 is checked, and make sure that NURB surfaces and NURB curves are unchecked. Just, you know, make sure everything works as it should. OK, export it to wherever you want to export it. We're just going to use a sample folder and say Carrick Sins Ready. As you'll see, you'll often get an error message saying something not implemented in the EXP version. That's just basically saying, I don't like that you have a texture attached. And when we go to the folder, sample folder that we made, you see it'll also export the texture. We don't need this, so we can just delete it, no problem. For personally, to speed up individual conversions, I made a .bat file, which what happens is when I make a copy of the .xsi file that I want to convert, I name it R, simple, then I double click on the .bat file, and it doesn't seem to want to work. Oh wait, that's right, it's because I copied the wrong file. See, that's what happens if you try. So I mentioned a lot earlier that the 3DS file does not work with ConvertXSI. It'll just give you an error. When it works, checks through everything, and suddenly, boom, you now have a converted .mesh. Now, as we saw earlier, I didn't properly attach all the textures in the file itself. I mean, in SoftImage itself. So you can do this in Notepad or Notepad++. I prefer Notepad++, it's just a better program. And I remember the references for my files, so... click click. Now where is the thruster? Because we have a thruster. Diffuse. DA. And personally, if you don't have an actual specular map or actual normal map, you probably should be using stand-ins for those. Personally, I have a stand-in called blacknm.dds. These two. Let's use them, again, stand-ins, or for things like thrusters, where you don't really need a bump map for a thruster. You just need what it looks like and the lighting effects. And now that this is done, we've finished the file. We've finished converting all the way from 3ds Max to properly putting on hard edges and hard points. And poof, I'll be including the .xsi bat file in the description. the other files here, namely these three DLL files and convert XSI, are actually included in your Sins of the Solar Empire directory. To look at mine as an example, see convert XSI, and we're done. Alternatively, you can always actually open up a command prompt and just do like convert XSI r.xsi, then type in converted.mesh. Let's just take the file, because you actually have to have a file in the folder for it to work. And now we have another converted mesh. And see, this is the details that you get if you actually do the full command prompt, but sometimes that can take a lot more time than you really want to spend when converting things. Well, I hope you found this video helpful, and if you have any other questions, feel free to post them on the Sins forum, or post them here in the chat, in the comment section, and I'll answer them the best I can. Good luck and happy modding!